Hey, I'm glad you dialed in here, and we are going to try to walk with you through how to share with people how it is that they can receive the gift of salvation. And it's something I hope every believer, every family church believer for sure, can have the confidence to walk with somebody through this story. And what I've learned is that people often know the basic information, but unless they have a way to present it, they won't feel confident. And if they don't feel confident, then they often won't start. So I'm gonna try to make this simple for you. It can be done in more complex ways, but this will be simple. And first of all, out of the four things that you need to communicate and walk through as you're talking with somebody, they're mostly very simple things that you already know. And the first one is that there's a God who loves you. There's a God who is holy. The Bible describes God as he really is. And people often make up their own picture of God, but to have a relationship with God, you have to understand really who he is. This is his story. And so that idea that first of all, there is a God and the Bible talks about him. And I usually see this as sort of a dialogue that comes one bit at a time. It's not a sales presentation that you have to get all the way through. It's a step. And let's talk about who you see God to be. And quite often people have really interesting pictures of God that they've just kind of picked a smorgasbord of various things. And so that's usually the first discussion is who is God, that he's the creator of the universe, that he loves us, that he's a holy God. And the second point comes very soon after that, and that is the problem is that we are separated from God by sin. That the Bible says we're born in sin because of the Adam and Eve and the sin that has come down all the way through the human race. And then in addition, we have each chosen to do our own thing and to step away from God and to be disobedient. And some of us feel great shame and guilt for that. And some people have what the Bible says is a conscience that's been seared. They don't even feel that guilty, but we're all guilty of sin and that separates us from God. And usually I have a dialogue then and say, so do you think that you've sinned or do you see that there's sin in your life? And have you done things that were wrong? And sometimes that's a great process if they begin to talk about the hurts in their life and the sin. And usually there's an uncovering of that, yeah, I'm broken somewhere, I'm not right. And then you can go from the bad news to the good news. And of course, some of the verses that you would be helpful to share as you go through this process is Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And so I think it's helpful to walk with people through, you know, terrible axe murderer people. Yeah, they've sinned. But people who are very good, moral, kind, they buy Girl Scout cookies, they take care of their neighbors in the snowstorms, those kind of people are still lost as well. That it's not about our goodness, it's about the fact that we're all separated from God by sin. And so Romans 3:23 says that, all have sinned. And then over a couple of pages is Romans 6:23, and it says the wages of sin is death. That we are spiritually dead, separated from God, and if we stay that way, then we end up in hell, which is eternal death. So then that's the bad news. The wages of sin is death. Then the verse goes on and it says, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, his son. And so then you can begin to say the third part. We need to talk about Jesus, that he was fully God and fully man, that he came to earth, that he experienced life as we did. He taught about what God is like. But at the ultimate end, he gave his life as a willing sacrifice. And he became the sacrificial lamb that paid for the sin of the world, that ended that total separation that we've had if we will believe. And so those three things you have to start with, that there is a God who loves you, he's the God of the Bible, that we are sinful and separated from God and there's nothing we can do to save ourselves. And thirdly, that Jesus is the only way. In fact, John 14:6 is a verse that I often bring up. It says, where Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And often people believe that Jesus is a great teacher, the great man. They may think he's a good moral person. But when Jesus said, I'm the only bridge, and I like to use the picture of a bridge, that there's only one bridge that goes to that relationship with God. And Jesus said, you have to understand, I'm the only one. And because of his death and burial and resurrection, he was able to provide a way for us to be forgiven and to be adopted and to have a relationship with God. And sometimes people will say, I believe that. I believe there's a God. I believe I'm a sinner. I believe Jesus is God's son, that he came and he died on the cross and was raised from the dead. And they feel like all they have to do is intellectually believe that. And of course, that's where the fourth thing comes in. And this is often where people are stuck. And the fourth thing is where you say, okay, I am going to put my faith in Jesus. I am going to trust him with my life. He is now going to be the boss, the Lord of my life. And I'm going to believe that my eternal salvation, my forgiveness, that everything that I need comes from Jesus, and I'm going to put my life in His hands. And it's that personal commitment of saying, Jesus, I give you my life, and Jesus, by His Spirit, comes and lives inside of us, and He begins to change us from the inside out. And sometimes I tell the story of a guy who put a wire over Niagara Falls, and he walked over, and he was on the Canadian side, and he walked over, and he's balancing on his balance, you know, on his wire with the balance beam and all that, and people were like, you know, scared for him, and there was a whole crowd on the American side, and finally he got over and he stepped off onto the platform, and everybody applauds and say, we're so glad, partly we didn't want you to die. And then he says to the crowd after they're done applauding, he says, how many of you believe I can walk across back to the Canadian side on the same wire? And of course they all put up their hands. It's like, we saw you do it, we know you can do that. And then he said, that's really good, because I need a volunteer. And he pulled up a wheelbarrow that had the rubber tire removed, and he put it on the wire, and he said, I'd like a volunteer to get in here, and I'll take you back to the other side. And all of a sudden, the crowd got really quiet. And I think that's a great description of what the difference between believe about God, that you can believe all these true things about Jesus, but until you climb into the wheelbarrow and you say, my life is in your hands, and everything I need comes from you, and I give you the right to call the shots in my life. That's the kind of belief that's saving faith. And that's not only what moves us from death to life, but that's also what starts this wonderful adventure of God changing our hearts and working in us and changing us to be more like Jesus. And so I hope if you can explain more about that story, you can tell some of your own story in the process, but those four simple things, that there's a God who loves you, that we are separated from that loving God by sin, that Jesus came, gave His life so that He could be the sacrifice, so that we could have a relationship with God. And fourthly, that we need to make that personal commitment that says, okay, I choose to believe, I choose to put my life in your hands. And if you get somebody to that place where they say, yeah, that sounds good, don't stop right then. Say, would you like to pray right now? I would love to pray with you. And often they're very concerned about praying out loud. And usually what I do is to say, I'll pray first. And I just pray that God would hear them and that their heart would be ready and that they would understand everything that we've talked about. And then I encourage them to just repeat after me. And I say, Jesus, I want you to come into my life and take over. Please forgive me of all my sin. I will make you the master and Lord of my life. And from now on, I'm going to try to obey you and follow you. In Jesus' name, amen. And you lead them one phrase at a time. And often when they have made that simple prayer, I look up and there's tears coming down their cheeks, and they're aware that there's been an eternal change that's been made. And I tell you, if you are privileged to pray with somebody at that point where they are ready to give their life to Christ, your life will never be different, and certainly their life will. I mean, your life will always be different and their life will always be different. So I hope you have the courage to not only start this process, but to go take it to a conclusion and to see God use you in the life of somebody else.